Hello, aquaponics growers. So today I have one question for you. Do you think it is possible to completely close the loop in aquaponics? So you know that in my different aquaponics videos, I always try to push sustainability very far in aquaponics. I focus on the size of the pump, on a lot of different things to reduce the consumption of energy resources and the impact on the environment. And today the question is, will we be able to run an aquaponics setup without adding anything in the setup and to run it by itself in a completely closed environment? That's what we're going to see today in this video. So if you are new to this channel, please subscribe. I'm going to release one video every week. So what do we mean by closing the loop? So let's take the example of the water. You know, in aquaponics, we put some water in the system and the system is closed. So the water remains in the system and runs continuously. So we could think that the loop is completely closed. But what happened is that in aquaponics, we got some evaporation, right? So there is the sun going in the setup and some water is evaporated. Also, when the vegetables are growing, they are composed of a high percentage of moisture. So when you harvest your vegetables, you remove water from the system, which means that the water level in your aquaponic system is decreasing and you have to add water in the system. So yes, somewhere we close the loop, but the loop is still open to the environment because we have some evaporation, we consume some vegetables and we remove some water from the system. So the loop is maybe closed, but we need to add new material. And my question to you is, would it be possible to basically stop adding new material, not from a water perspective, but from a fish food or nitrogen perspective? So let's be clear. In aquaponics, we try to be super sustainable. We limit the quantity of power, of energy that we need. You know, if you compare it to a classic aquaculture or a classic hydroponic system, the consumption of energy in aquaponics is quite low. So that's a really good point. The consumption of water as well is very low. So the limited resources such as water are very, very well utilized in aquaponics. We are in a system where the water is kind of trapped. And as I said before, we got some evaporation, but the consumption is definitely lower than classic gardening, classic aquaculture. So from those perspectives, we are really good in aquaponics. But there is one thing where we are not so good is from the fish food consumption. The fish food that we use in aquaponics is the same that the one is used in aquaculture. And therefore, we have a negative impact on the environment because the fish food is composed of fish meal. And this fish meal, obviously, it's fish that are trapped in the ocean, they are caught in the ocean, they are processed. And all this has an impact on the natural resources, on the population of fish, natural population of fish that are caught in the ocean, and also on the energy, because you need a lot of energy to transform it into pellets. And that's the pellet that most of us use in aquaponics. So the question is, if we use an alternative to this to those fish pellets, if we produce our own fish food, and we use it in the aquaponic setup, and if we produce this fish food thanks to what we produce with the setup, can we just close the loop and therefore being kind of self-sufficient? It's very interesting, and there are different techniques, right? I made some videos about duckweed. So duckweed, they are floating plants. So I got some here. You see those green fins on my hand. Probably don't see much, but I made a special video about it, and you can produce them and you can feed your fish with it. They grow very fast, but the reality of the duckweed is that only specific species of fish are able to eat them. You know, a fish that is carnivore, a fish that is a predator, will not be able to eat the duckweed. So depending on the species, you can use those duckweed and you can grow them with the water of your aquaponic setup. So in this way, you could think that you close the loop. Same thing if you grow insects. I made a video about insects we can see that it's possible to grow insects and to feed them thanks to some vegetables that we will grow in aquaponics. In this way, we'll use the vegetables to feed the insects, and then we'll use the insects to feed the fish. And the fish, when they poo, they feed the plants. So you see, we also close the loop somewhere. I mean, it seems that we close the loop. But when we think about it, you know, an aquaponic system is like a black box. What we do currently with our aquaponic systems is that we add some fish food in the system and we get some vegetables and some fish. So if we stop adding fish food in the system, and obviously we produce the fish food thanks to the system, but we continue to collect vegetables and to collect fish, at one point we're going to decrease the quantity of proteins, of nitrogen available in the system. Not only nitrogen, but also minerals and a bunch of other things. Which means that at one point or another, the system is going to be weaker and weaker, and at one point the system is not going to produce, it's almost going to be empty. If you see the representation of the ecosystem as a black box, you can imagine that at one point you're going to empty the system of all the nitrogen, all the nutrients that are necessary for the system to work. And therefore, at one point, you empty everything and you can't produce anymore. So we need to add something in the system. But it doesn't necessarily need to be fish food. So the fish food we use at the moment, as I said before, is not sustainable. And it has a negative impact on the planet. So if we use those two ways of recycling or of producing some fish food, so duckweed or insects, then we can add nitrogen under another form. Instead of adding it under the form of fish food, we can simply add in it in terms of nutrient for the plant. So it could be simply adding some fertilizer or adding just a compost tea. You know, you compost all the organic waste that you have at home. You can collect the compost tea, and this compost tea is very high in nitrogen as well and very high in minerals and other things. So you could technically add this compost tea in your aquaponic setup. I'm not saying that's a good thing to do, because there are some risks, because on the compost you do, you got a lot of pesticides on the fruits, on the skin of the vegetables that you are eating, right? And that's why sometimes we peel the vegetables off, we put them in the compost. But then if you put this in your aquaponic system, you have some risk to add some pesticides in the system. So if you do this, please wash your vegetables before throwing anything into the compost. But the point is, you can definitely, instead of adding fish food in the system, you can swap it for fertilizer for the plant. I mean, as long as you add nitrogen in the system somewhere, then the system can continue to run and you can collect the vegetables and the fish in the other side. So it's even better, right? Because the fish food, we need to buy it, but the compost at home, you got waste. We all got waste, right? We call it table waste. So it's organic waste. So I was talking about it, the fruits, the vegetables that you eat, even if you have leftover of meat or whatever. All this can be composted, fermented, and you can basically get the juice, what we call the tea. And this can go back in the system. And some people are experimenting of putting a compost bin on top of the aquaponic setup, where basically the compost tea is going directly in the setup. So then you need to be able to manage the quantity of nitrogen in your system. So if you take this option, you will have to record those levels of ammonia, nitrate and nitrate that you have in your water, and the pH as well. But it's one option. Now, is it possible to completely close the loop? The obvious response would be no, right? If you completely close the loop, if you don't add any nutrient, if you don't add any compost tea in your system, the system is going to be weak, weak, weak. That's the obvious response, but there are some tricks to basically maintain a good level of nitrogen in a system without physically adding nitrogen in the system, and that's what we're going to talk about right now. So if you look at the atmosphere, you understand that the atmosphere is composed of different gas, right? We got oxygen, 20-21%, we got CO2 and other rare gas around 1%, but there is one gas that is in very high concentration, 78%, and that's nitrogen. and nitrogen is what we need to grow our plants, right? Then it's just different forms of nitrogen. And the plants, most of the plants are unable to absorb the nitrogen that is into the atmosphere. But there are some specific family, we call it the fallacy, and those species, they have developed a symbiosis relationship with some bacteria. And those bacteria are basically able to trap the nitrogen that is into the air and to transform it into nitrogen that is available for the plant. So you can think of it. I'm not saying that I am able to manage this or that anyone is able to do it at the moment, but in the future, you can completely think of a system where you have in your grow bed a very big grow bed and a low concentration of fish. And in this grow bed, you have different plants, plus you have a lot of fabaceae plants who are basically releasing nitrogen into the soil. And therefore, the concentration of nitrogen is always present, so your plants are always producing, and then from those plants, you can then feed your fish, or you can just use the water that is high in nitrogen to grow some duckweed and feed your fish, or you grow some insects and feed your fish, but you understand the principle. Here, you close the loop. Never completely close the loop, because you still have a problem of minerals. At one point or another, you still need to have potassium, calcium, and a lot of other minerals in the loop, but not in big quantities. So you see, somewhere we are very close to be able to close the loop on the paper, in theory. Now, in practice, you would need a very big grow bed to be able to do that, but it's still a possibility. So I hope this opens your mind and respond to the question, can I completely close the loop to my aquaponics setup? If you are new to aquaponics, you know that I offer you a 6-steps guide training that is available in the description of the video just below. And in this training, you will find some crucial, very, very important information to be able to build your own aquaponics setup, but also to manage it in the best conditions and to be able to produce sustainable, healthy and tasty food at home in your own backyard. So download it, it's just below, you just have a link to follow. If you enjoy the video, don't forget to leave it a like, that's very important for me. I hope to see you soon in the next video, bye bye.
Don't forget to get your free gift from this screen. You can also leave me a comment below the video, subscribe to the channel and see my last video. I really hope to see you soon, and I wish you a fantastic success with aquaponics. Have a good crop!